Amen. I don't know, but I just feel led to say, even before we begin, that, you know, for some of you, your place of struggle is your place of promise. The very thing that you're struggling with, that's your place of promise. And in my family, we have a saying, we're funeralizing my uncle, Ricky Thomas. He was one of the leading pioneers on WMEM years ago, and we're going to be funeralizing him on Saturday. And he used to tell us all the time, a man that don't work, don't eat. And how many of you know the same principle applies in the kingdom of God? Because what you have to learn is how to be fruitful even when you're going through. The truth of the matter is, everybody's going through something. Can I get a witness? Is there anybody in here that just woke up on a bed of roses and some angels came to your house and carried you to the bathroom and you floated on wings, amen, all the way to work and did everything, and then when you came home, every bill was paid. Oh my God, you didn't owe nobody. Is there anybody in here like that? Because I want to go home with you at the end of the service. But if you're like me, there's struggle. But the place of your struggle is the place of your blessing. And all God wants to know is, can you hold on to what you're going through? Because if you ain't got no test, you really ain't got no testimony. And the truth of the matter is that you can't testify of the goodness of God unless you know for yourself that He is good. How can you say God is a healer if you've never been through any sickness? How can you say God is a provider if you never had a bill that you were waiting to be paid? But I feel like David, he said, I once was young, and now I'm old, but I would never see the righteous forsaken. Where you are, amen, is where we've all been. We got young people in here that's struggling to live for the Lord. We got young people in here that's struggling to see their vision come to pass. And aren't you glad for a man of God that would open up? See, that's how Reverend Linwood Cooper used to be with us. It didn't matter how late it was. We'd stay in the church all night long. We'd be writing pieces of songs, and they didn't make any sense. And we'd be banging on the piano and singing all night long. And it didn't seem to make any sense at the time. But he would never stop us. He said, y'all just go ahead. Make sure y'all put on the alarm and turn off the lights before you leave. Why? Because he knew that we were at a place of struggle. But he appreciated the fact that we were not going to give up. And I thank God, because it's something about God. You may not really be hearing him answer you in the midnight hour. But don't you fool yourself. He's still your Jehovah Jireh. He's still your provider. You know, sometimes it looks like nothing is going to happen. Has anybody ever been in a place where you're praying and praying and asking God for an answer, and it seems like nothing is happening? It's like you're in some kind of a holding pattern. Anybody ever been on a plane and you're anxious for the plane to land? You're anxious to get to your destination, but it seems like God has you in a holding pattern. Landing. He wants everything to be right. The Bible says that the blessings of the Lord are sure, and they don't add any sorrow. I don't want no man in my life that's going to give me sorrow. I don't want no job if it's going to give me sorrow. You can keep the new car if I can't pay for it. Come on, somebody. What good is it to have a new house and a mansion on the hill, and you walk in the floor at night wondering how you're going to make the payments? Give me a double wide trailer and let me give the Lord praise.
Yeah.
all day long. You can keep that praise. But you got to find something in your life to look back over your life and begin to give God glory for. You might not have everything that you want, but he's always giving you everything that you need. Ain't nobody in here dying. Is there anybody in here dying of famine? Amen. Anybody got peanut butter and jelly in the cabinet? As long as you got peanut butter and jelly and the ends of the pieces of bread, you doing all right, baby. Don't tell me you ain't got everything that you need. But after you begin to hang on in there, somebody say hang on in there, then what happens is that he moves you from a place of just supplying all of your need to a place where you can get the desires of your heart. But the problem is your heart has to be conditioned. Touch your neighbor and say conditioned. See, because sometimes your heart got to be circumcised. There are certain things and people that is in your heart that sometimes you got to cut off. He's not going to give you the desires of your heart if you know you're going to take the money and give to Benny and Jack and Jerry. He's not going to do that. Hello, somebody. But when he gives you the desires of your heart, he's going to put you in a place where your mindset is ready to receive those things. Yeah. Sometimes we are between a rock and a hard place. Amen. And on tonight, I want you to go with me very quickly to the book of Jude. And I promise you, I'm going to be out your way. I just came to preach a word and encourage somebody on tonight. Is that all right? Yeah. Amen. Amen. Go to the book of Jude very quickly. Amen. I just want to look at one scripture on tonight. Amen. The book of Jude. Amen. The third verse. Amen. In the book of Jude, a very short book, right before Revelation. Amen. Any Bible sword drill scholars in here? We used to compete in Bible band and YBWW to make sure we found the scripture, but then we found out we only knew the first three words. But we need to know the word. Touch your neck and say, you need to know the word.
You need to know the word.
Because when you don't have anything else, thank God for the word. I don't know about you, but how many of you are living just on the promise? I mean, you don't even have to see the manifestation of it. But just the word alone, if somebody can give you, if God can send you a word, that's enough encouragement to really keep you going. Amen? Amen? So in the third verse, the Bible says that Jude writes, Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you, or rather to push you, that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. Now, what does it mean to contend? It means literally to fight. Now, I know some people that will fight over anything. Oh, I have them in my family. They'll fight you over a plant at the cemetery. Hello, somebody. They will fight you. They live to fight. They love to have arguments. Y'all know anybody? Am I the only one that have people in my family like that? I mean, just argue over anything. Watching TV and declare you wrong about something. Just will fight over anything. And how is it that we will fight over everything else, but we won't stand for the promises of God in our lives? You got people all the time that's trying to rain on your parade, trying to make you think that God is not faithful and just, that he's not going to deliver what his promise said unto you. You got people trying to tell you give up and throw in the towel all the time. Every time you look on the television, they'll make you believe you're not good enough, or you're not pretty enough, or you're not this, or you don't have enough money. But how many of you know the devil is a liar? Jude is telling us you have to fight. His very name means fight. If you know anything about the derivative of his name, it's either Judas or Judah. And one thing I've come to find out is that that's a place where many people fall in between. It's a paradox. Because there are some people that will praise God one day and deny him the next. They'll praise God as long as we're in the sanctuary and it looks good, they can praise God. But you let them go home and somebody done ate their last ramen noodles and seem like all heck is going to break loose in ours. Who ate the last ramen noodle in here? But you got to stand on the promises of God. This is a day that we're living in when the devil is trying to throw everything he can at us. And it's not enough for us just to have a black president, because he needs prayer too. Hello, somebody. And we're coming to find out that we can't put our trust in man. Everybody thought that was going to be the the salvation of the nation. But I got news for you. Tell your neighbor, you still got to fight. The reason you got to fight is because failure is not an option in your life. If God wants you to fail, you wouldn't even be here right now. If God didn't want you to make it, you wouldn't be right here right now. If God didn't want you to be successful, you wouldn't here to be here to hear the word that's coming out of my mouth prophesying unto you tonight. I'm speaking a word in each and every believer's life on tonight that God is a rewarder. But you got to fight. You got to do your part. Touching them and say, you got to do your part. In other words, ask your neighbor, what do you do?
What do you do?
Do you just sit around and wait for God to drop the blessing down in your house like he going to come in there and just drop it on you? Is there anybody here that believes in the power of prayer? Is there anybody here that believes in the power of fasting? See, we don't believe in that no more, honey. She was going to die there.
Right.
To die. They said, there's nothing we can do. There's a blockage in our heart, and there's nothing more we can do. The saints all over began to pray for her. And when they took the next cardiogram and they looked at it and see what was going on, they couldn't find the blockage. I know God is a healer. I know God is a healer. You're looking at a person that was driving down the street. I pulled over for a moment to drop my sister off, and before I knew it, a young man came up to me and stuck a gun right in my face. Grabbed the keys out my hand. Got in the car, began to drive off, and my baby was in the back seat. And I had to beg him. I said, please, please, let me get my baby out. He said, get the baby. I grabbed the car seat. I grabbed everything. See, the problem with us is that we too fancy and too, you know, sadistic. But when he told me to get the baby, do you think I stood there trying to get the locker? I grabbed the whole seat, the baby, everything. Tell your neighbor, you got to hold on. When it says, touch not my anointed, do my prophet no harm, you don't understand the power that you have. See, that's why, really, to be honest with you, your fighting can sometimes just be in you standing still.
That's right.